Ravage then. But we're the only real lockdown to try and get to the Tidehunter, and even that, well, they all have lockdown, but all their lockdown is disabled very easily by the Kraken shell, and the ultimate can come through very easily from the Tidehunter. It is the response Death Prophet for Yawer, probably going to be the one picking that up, going in towards that mid lane, potentially. Death Prophet does a lot of damage to the Alchemist. Alchemist, of course, not a very tanky hero by nature, doesn't have that much armor to his name, and the Death Prophet ultimate, which is entirely composed of physical damage, will be ripping him apart completely and utterly.
Reserve time.
Now, for the first time, dipping his little toes into the pool of reserve time that he does have for himself, Bulba's thinking about what to go for the safe lane and for the secondary support, it will be the Shadow Demon. It's something we do see come, something that we've seen trending a little bit, but I don't particularly like the Shadow Demon in general. I think it's good pairing it up with, I'll talk about that in a while, it's good pairing that up with a few different types of heroes. The Husker pick coming through from Fear, this is very preemptive, but with the Oracle having been picked up in the early game, it does make me think that this was quite possibly the plan all along. There isn't that much pure damage or anything really to be able to deal with the Huskar. The only major issues that he will have is armor toggling in the acid spray. The Alchemist come late game can do some significant damage to the Huskar. I suppose the Radiance is also a little bit annoying with that evasion coming through. Huskar, though, will be taking a lot of damage to the Shadow Demon Soulcatcher. So to those of you who don't know, Soulcatcher damage type is basically pure damage. Most of Shadow Demon's damage is pure. His third ability, the Shadow Poison, also... Wait, Shadow Poison doesn't do pure damage? I thought Shadow Poison did pure damage. Well, anyway, the Soulcatcher does increase damage by a percentage of the damage you're dealing. So it has additional pure damage on top. So that makes the Shadow Demon very, very strong against the Huskar. That being said, the Huskar could definitely work out. There's not that many big counters. The only real counter that I can see is the Shadow Demon. Obviously, no real massive amounts of lockdown, no real massive amounts of stunners or anything coming through, no bashers, no faceless void. Slardar very good against the Huskar. They could go for a Slardar. I would actually really like the Slardar ban to come out from Fear, because a Slardar in the safe lane is still something that the Huskar needs to be very, very wary of. Slardar also very good against the Death Prophet. It helps considerably in trying to burst her down.
5 seconds remaining.
Like boy, welcome to the stream.
Team pick.
Alchemist just isn't one of those heroes that's picked a lot in the NEL. I think he's largely ignored, and for good reason, mostly because Alchemist is just one of those heroes that can be assaulted in the lane very significantly. So it needs very good team coordination to be able to pull off at a very high level. And although these players are definitely all very good, it's not going to be the same thing as having a coordinated team. The closest thing you're going to be having is, of course, Bulba and Arteezy on the same squad. On the opposite side, the Dire does have a lot more synergy. So in terms of actual people playing up on either team, I've got to give the big advantage to Dire. Fear, Somel, and Yawer kind of teammates. Somel and Yawer have played together quite a bit. Fear and Yawer have played together quite a bit. OG and Moon and Crit, obviously, both teammates as well, both in OG. So the Tyrant pick does come through, so my prediction is correct over there. But I would really like a Slardar in the safe lane. It's good against the Ricky too, but that's not really anything that's important. A Slardar would be the perfect pick for the Radiant side.
10 seconds.
If they pick up a Slardar, I will hands down say that I prefer the Radiant draft. If they do not, then it really depends on what else they could go for. But ultimately, like right now, I see nothing but pluses for the Slardar pick. You can go for some damage. You can fight very well without the Alchemist as well. It's decent synergy with the Earth Spirit. It's good team fight potential. Your Alchemist is going to be your main farmer anyway, so you need a safe laner who doesn't soak up too much farm.
Axe.
It is the Axe pickup though, and well, it's good. It's obviously a great counter to Huskar, and I can see why they picked it up, but I still feel as if the Slardar would just have been able to do more. because he's also very good against the Death Prophet. Now, Axe can be very good against the Death Prophet, but that relies on Axe actually building a blade mill to be able to return all the damage out of the Death Prophet. And even then, the Yule Scepter can prove to be a bit of a very difficult task to deal with, the blade mill only lasting about 5 seconds, and half of that can be negated by the Yule Scepter timing if Yawr does time get that off in the perfect timing. So we're going to be moving into the introduction. We've got Balwa picking up that Batrider MSS on the Earth Spirit MG, the legendary support who I've been told so much about on the Shadow Demon, and Zumbaman on the Alchemist. And finally, we do have Arteezy picking up that safe lane. Axon on the die side, we have Fair Old Man Dota himself going up on to the Huskar. We've got the Oracle being played up by Somel. We do have the Death Prophet being picked up by none other than his brother Yawr. And finally, we have the Tidehunter and the Rikimaru being piloted up by Moon and Crit respectively. This is the first time I have seen Crit play up on a support in the North American Elite League, and it just goes to show how much more serious this game is when Crit is playing up on his signature hero, that Rikimaru is that he's so absolutely famous for. Moon Meander also going into his favored position, favored role, going into the offlane, going to be picking up the Tidehunter for himself. No rune wards being put down. Crit actually prioritizing getting vision behind the tier 1 tower off the Radiant side. They do have some very impressive ward vision, ward coverage of the two lanes, but so far no sentry. There is a dust and there is a sentry on Matumbaman. He should be able to get the D ward onto the mid lane, but the hour can be slowed up. Great Siphon already being skilled up. It's a full on engagement so far. A nice Fortune Zen going out onto three people though. So Mel doing very well. Fair is going to be the one who gets taken down though. That will be first blood going the way of the Radiant side. Crit. No, wait, what? Oh god, no, what? Crit actually picked up first blood. Crit got a kill onto the Batrider. I'm honestly blind right now. Actually, that's not true, the new of 2000. I've seen Elder Titan a lot. I've seen Elder Titan being picked like a crazy amounts. Now, Fair on this top lane, gonna be slowed up by MSS, but they won't really be able to do all that much. But now, that is going to be MG, who's gonna be the aggressor onto Crit right now. MSS, of course, has his dust, will be forced to use it. Fortune's End comes out, that might be all they need to allow Crit to escape, but three charges of Shadow Poison on him, he narrowly evades the potential one more Shadow Poison coming through. MG not able to get that kill over there, so a bit unfortunate for him. Bot lane though, that's where I'm interested to see how Arteezy will be faring up against this Tidehunter. Both these heroes are traditionally very good against other melee heroes, so far I'm going to go ahead and call this an entirely skill-based one-on-one. OG Crit, very very low, will be making his way towards that top rune, trying to secure that for his Death Prophet, make sure that if it's a bounty rune it doesn't go the way of the Alchemist, which is really what they're more concerned about. Matumbaman on that Alchemist snowballing would be an absolute catastrophe for them. He's gone for 2 points in the Greedy Greed. He's going for the very, very greedy build, actually. Well, bot lane, Arteezy going onto Moon, getting a complete man fight going his way, but now Moon turns around. He's got the anchor smash up in a couple of seconds, chooses to hold on to it, but now turns around with a couple of right clicks, could maybe try and make it go onto Arteezy. Arteezy does, of course, have the massive regen advantage. Moon is diving, deep for it. Arteezy should be able to get this kill over here, actually gets the call just in time, but Moon getting overzealous, getting over aggressive, and overestimating his damage output, not getting the anchor smash off in time. The call having just a little bit higher radius, or actually might actually be of equal radius to the anchor smash, but Arteezy just getting it off, timing it perfectly. And even with the level 2 anchor smash, that wouldn't have been a kill. That anchor smash does do physical damage, and with Axe having the ring of protection, that a lot of that physical damage is negated and probably would not have been killed. Now Somel on the Oracle will be able to purge away the Sticky Napalm using the Fortune's End. Crit silencing up MG, will be able to go on to him. MG should end up taking the fall. Huskar picks that up with a Burning Spears for Fair, getting a little bit more experience going his way. Smell. Dude, that three-man fortune zen was really good from Smell, though. I am casting from Pakistan, yes. And now it's going to be MG bringing up a soft towards the top lane for MSS. MSS might look to go in over here, though. But instead, doesn't really find an opening to do so. Mid lane, I need to keep an eye on this Moon once again. Going for an engagement up with RTZ, it's a bit of a kerfuffle. But this time, Tussle goes the way of Moon Meander. Why is there a courier here? There is a salve on the courier as well. Moon Meander being forced to go back. The courier intimidation tactics working out. As death, oh my god, there's solo kills everywhere. These should not be happening. I'm honestly amazed. I'm missing these because I don't expect them. I expect kills to be going on towards the top lane, which is exactly what's going to be happening. As NG throws out the disruption onto Fair. The Fortune Zen comes out onto two people, but it's not charged for very long. Fair going to be chased up by the Pathfinder. Will be able to turn around. Will be able to get a couple of burning spheres up. Will be able to get a little bit of damage, but won't be enough. MSS getting healed up and getting bursted down by Sumel. We'll be able to get the purifying flames onto him, and now Boba, he's the one in trouble. It's a 2-for-1 so far. Fear does go down, but Prit avenges it with a double kill. 700 gold on him. Going to be able to have a very easy build up towards that Diffusal Blade. Can pick up the Tranquil Boost right now if he wants to, but I'm imagine he might choose to save for the Blade of Alacrity. Would be a very good decision to make. Sumail, in the meanwhile, having a great game as a support, having participated in quite a few kills. I'm from Islamabad, but beyond that, I can't really talk about where I'm from. Okay, right now, he's almost got the face boost up. The roll coming through, though. MSS gets a boulder smash onto Goat. Boba's in pursuit. He misses a sticky napalm, and that'll be the end of it. Sumel able to get himself away. Yaur picking up the haste rune. Matumba man, bottle, 2 charges on him. The scan being used to make sure that he isn't clearing up any stacks, but so far Matumba Man hasn't even gotten any stacks up. 15 seconds without his ultimate, this should be a very dead Matumba Man. He uses his the exorcism comes out. Matumba Man should end up going down. In the meanwhile, in the top lane, there is an engagement going on. Shadow Demon getting a kill on to Sumel. Axe, oh my god, there's action in every lane. RTZ gets a kill onto Moon Meander. Yaur gets a kill onto Matumba Man, Crit gets a kill onto the Shadow Demon, and Shadow Demon gets a kill onto the Oracle. There is literally no way I can get all of these.
Radiant structures are fortified.
Now Bulba. Top lane. Quite a few napalm charges onto Fair. Should be able to pick this up if he chooses to go for it, but instead he does end up changing his mind, and Yaur is the one in the mid lane who's trying to be the aggressor. Arcane rune up on him. He's just trying to use as many spells as he can, trying to get out that maximum efficiency harass. While Alchemist happily bottling up a bounty rune for himself, uses it immediately, picks up 300 gold off of that. He's actually in a significant disadvantage as top lane. We do see the Hadouken catching out two of the Radiant side heroes is Crit. Phase boots now up on him. Did not go for the Tranquils or the Diffusal Blade. Preferred to go for the early on damage. And now we see another engagement going through. A rolling boulder in as Yaur gets a kill onto RTZ. Shadow Demon successfully manages to take down the Huskar. But now Crit is the one who's being pursued up. He's able to blink strike himself up towards Sumel. Good coordination coming through. Sumel turning himself around to get some right clicks out. Has the heal, has the Fortune's End in just a few seconds as well. It's only a level 1, so does not have the 6-second cooldown that does eventually come down. And Yaur once again coming out from the back lines, just doing so much damage towards Matumba Man, just harassing him out of the lane, making it impossible for the Alchemist to be able to lane up easily, even getting a kill onto RTZ with the help of a rune that he did get earlier on. Actually, not even needing a rune. Yaur not needing a rune or an ultimate, just with the help of Moon Meander, who still has his Ravage up and ready as well. If he chooses to try and go up towards that top lane with the Ravage, that could be an absolute game changer. Moon somehow is sitting a full level behind RTZ though. And thank you, Dinosaurus, I appreciate it. I've been playing this game for 12 years, so I should technically know a lot about the game. I just don't play very much. Seriously, I gave up on becoming, I gave up on gaining MMR about 2 years ago. I just play for fun now. But yeah, Vanguard on the Axe being purchased up. RTZ not going for the early on blink. We do so often see here if the blink would have been very useful, but right now there's a big rotation coming up to his way. Sumail gets out the Fortune's End and Yawr finishes him off. The 1-2 combination, the Brother Bowl, the Hassan Bowl, practically. This is could be a tier 1 tower that they're staring down, but Yawr not using his ultimate just quite yet. No bottle on him either. Did send it back on the courier, I do believe, and that's exactly what did happen. Once he gets that, then maybe they look to try and seize this up in Tomba Man. And meanwhile, Armlet almost up and ready for him. Fair though, it's an Armlet for him as well, but level 6 only. This Huskar is not having the time of his life. No, not at all. Actually, sitting in the top 4 net worth somehow, and the Tomba Man in the meanwhile, a long range Crypt Swarm coming up from Yawr will be enough to finish him off. And they even used the Ravage for that one, surprisingly enough. Probably going to be worth it. They do need to continue to put down this Alchemist again and again. And this is what I talked about. The Alchemist is just a hero that's very easy to punish. I don't really believe that there's anything like a Gentleman's Agreement not to pick an Alchemist or an Elder Titan.
Dire's top tower is under attack.
And now MS says he's the one who's going to be silenced up, but actually he turns around in time to be able to get a silence up, to be able to get a stun off as well. Now Kurt, he gets the smoke screen out, not even going to be needing it. Anisha does use it coming up from MG backlines. We see a call coming out from RTZ. He will be able to get the dunk onto the Ricky Maro, but in the backlines it's going to be Yawr who's being pursued up. Who's going to be flame breaked up. Matuma Man losing HP steadily despite having his ultimate form up and going. It is going to be Yawr who ends up getting the turnaround. Spirit Siphon is there. The Ghosts also come back towards him. It's just such a hard fight for that Radiant to win. The Yawr just continually being healed up again and again. The DD rune going to be going his way right now. Matuma Man throwing out the shadow, throwing out the acid spray, doing whatever he can. Yawr throws out the Veil of Discord. Will be able to turn around with massive damage. Matuma Man will end up going down regardless. RTZ, Yawr might not even fall over here. He gets a Spirit Siphon, his Wicked 6 free for Yawr, and suddenly RTZ. 3 to fall for the Radiant side, quite a few for the Dire. That was such a long winded team fight. People actually ended up respawning. I need the fight recap to see exactly who got the better trade. So it's a 5-3 overall towards the end. And Yawr absolutely outplaying everyone. And now they're going to be able to move themselves into the Roshan pit in fear. Armlet is up and ready. He doesn't really need all those fancy things. He actually could end up going down to the flame break, but the heal will be enough to keep him sustained up. Bulba going in, perhaps a big mistake. It's not really, no real perhaps about it. Yeah. Bulba calling it, but probably not going to be GG just quite yet. They don't want to be giving up without a fight right now. What they need to be looking forward is to Arteezy's Blink Dagger. I say that, but Arteezy is going for RTZ is going for a Midas. RTZ is going for a Midas. I'm going to say that again just so that it sinks into you guys and you understand what's happening. RTZ is going for a Midas. Hey, Tracer Booty, I like your name, man. I really like your name. Welcome to the stream. This game might be over very, very soon, and if this is over this quickly, that's no fun. I mean, I'm more than happy for costing one more game. It's not even that late for America, man. I need to, like, if tomorrow wasn't a Friday, I would be up all night costing this. I mean, I would be up all morning costing this, practically. Maybe tomorrow I go to sleep early and try to wake up at 5 a.m. to cost any help. Also, big shout out to all the Pakistani guys who are actually staying up to watch me play, to watch me cast. It's very appreciated, considering that there's so many of you tuning in at 5 a.m. in the morning. It's ridiculous, honestly. It's insane to imagine that people are willing to do this for me. Also, if you guys want more of me, you can always go check out my Facebook. Just type out exclamation mark Facebook. Well, Crit actually helping the neutral creeps kill out Matumba Man's Alchemist. Crit Blightstone now on him. Diffusal Blade en route as well.
Radiant's bottom tower is under attack.
And the hour in the meanwhile, tier 2 tower is under siege. Going to be doing quite a bit for himself. Well, top lane Axe, Arteezy is the one who's almost finished his Midas up. And although I do get why he's going for the Midas, it's a bit of a meme, but the Midas is effective. It's definitely going to help them come back into this game. I say that he actually isn't buying the Midas yet. I'm confused. Maybe he just saved some buyback. No, it is going to be the Midas, so I can see why he's going for it, but the Blink Dagger is the same amount of money and just seems so much more effective. This creep is ridiculous, man. This is a Scotty slow. This is literally a Scotty slow. I don't know if it goes through BKB. I need to press Alt. Okay, that doesn't tell me anything, but can someone tell me if that goes through BKB? And now, Nyara with the invisibility rune being bottled up as well. That's just, he's just having the time of his life, really. He's sitting at top of the net worth, 8,000 gold and 7 kills, 5 assists, 14 minutes in. Crit's gonna be the casualty over here, though. Arteezy, 500 gold on him. The Midas being a little bit useful. Yawer gonna be able to force stuff himself away, force the Alchemist to stun himself up. The call coming out onto him, it's being paired up with the Lion, with the Lasso, but they're able to get the Wicked 6 free on Axe, and although some people might argue that it's important to get onto Matumba Man, I think Arteezy getting it is the best case scenario at this point, simply because Arteezy desperately needs that Blink Dagger, and when he does get that up, that's going to be so much more teamfight potential coming after them. That's going to be Fair, who's very underfarmed himself. Fair is just sitting at the 4th highest net worth. Arteezy and Alchemist are slowly catching up to the Dead Prophet, and anytime now they should be closing the gap very, very shortly, especially if they're able to get a couple more kills like that. Yawer will not be able to stay ahead the way that he is. Oh god, dude, we have family lunches tomorrow. Oh man, that's gonna suck. I might actually end up buying an energy drink for tomorrow. The shadow poison coming through. I can actually see the daylight. I've been up all night casting. The shadow poison coming through as well. Matumba Man. The arcane rune being pinged out by the Tidehunter. And now in long range, roll coming through was a bit... It was a little bit optimistic from MSS, but MSS doesn't really hurt to try. If he was able to get the kickback, that would have been big, but I think what's really big is the next pickup from the Rikimaru, as Arteezy does miss his call. He's trying to TP himself away. Will be able to do so with the Ravage even being forced out. That's arguably worth it, but Arteezy is not going for the Blink Dagger. He's going straight for the Shiva's Guard, or maybe it's an Assault Christ, but I don't know about this decision. He's getting a lot tankier, and that's true, but he needs a way to be able to close the distance. The only other way that I can think of is if the Earth Spirit is able to kick the Arteezy in, but that's not really something you want to be relying on. The kick is so useful for being able to follow up. If you get the boulder smash onto a couple of people who are called up, and all that thought, Courier won't be going down, but MG might be. MG, though, with the dust, with the sentry ward, Skrit decides not to mess with him just quite yet. The ultimate being used by Yawer. Interesting build from Crit as well, not maxing the smoke screen that we do normally see coming out, but Yawer, ultimate used up, will be able to pick up the tier 2, we should be backing off very, very shortly. Without the Ravage, they probably don't want to be going up onto the high ground. Possibly an Aetherlands on its way, and they rotate over trying to go for a tier 2. If Alchemist is able to pick up this tier 2 tower in exchange, this is more than worth it. Two tier 2 towers for one at this point is the best they can actually hope for. An Alchemist has basically closed up the gap almost completely with the Death Prophet. If he's able to pick up this last hit on the tower, he's able to get up all these creeps, and he should be able to break his way into the lead in terms of the net worth, and should be able to pick up that relic for himself if that's what he's going to go for. But right now, Huskar picking up the last hit. Now Balbon drums forward, he's trying to get some L, will be able to do so probably. The boulder smash comes through as well as the smoke, the TP coming out from the Alchemist, he's trying to get himself away. The burning spear is barely going to be able to live through that damage, not a bit too scared to even deactivate the armory just in case he does it at the wrong time and the burning spears are able to dig him out. Now it's Kratos getting some good wards out. Diffusal blade up on him, he can feel a lot more stable for himself and be a lot happier because he's going to be able to, sorry, a lot more safe about his own life. Dire's middle tower is under attack. the shots were fired. But right now, I mean, Bulba almost at the Blink Dagger, and I talked about Axe getting the Blink Dagger and that being instrumental, and surely that will be, but once Bulba gets that, that's going to be playing a similar purpose. If he's able to drag up the Death Prophet, if they're able to get a couple of good pulls onto that, if there is a Force Staff coming out onto anyone, so there's no Force Staff, that's a bit of an issue, but even if they're able to get a good lasso out on the Death Prophet, that could be a complete game changer at that point. If they're able to kill her before she gets off her exorcism, that's a team fight one right there. And a couple more one team fights, and this Alchemist will be snowballing out of control. He actually went for a Midas as well. So they're going full in greed on this. If they win a single team fight right now, I'm going to go ahead and call this. Radiant are going to be in the lead, without a doubt. Right now, their gold deficit isn't looking to be that much. It's only about 3,000 in the lead of the Dire side. Experience as well, practically even at this point. The only real difference is map control and how well these items are used up. That being said, the sun being channeled out from Matumba Man throws it onto Fear. Very good decision making from him. He's trying to dodge out the body blocks coming through, but Boonum just a little bit too good for him, and Matumba Man will end up going down. Two Fear's Huskar. Moon with a nice little place coming out. He's able to get the body blocks through. Definitely well played by him. Sitting very close towards that Blink Dagger as well, just about 50 gold away. Threat with the Diffusal Blade and Shadow Demon with the Dome of Knowledge pickup. Just trying to get closer and closer towards that level 4 disruption. Trying to do what he can to make sure that, well, there's no real damage dealers on the Dire side which you can disrupt up, and they smoke right underneath the Radiant Observer and Sentry Wards. This is something that's a big blunder, and this is something that could cost them the game, essentially. If they lose this team fight, I'm going to be blaming it completely on the smoke. The smoke does give them the ability to put down some vision onto the high ground, and so far, I mean, it looks okay. The smoke really not doing too much at all. Moon doesn't have his Blink Dagger just quite yet. They're not waiting for that. They might come to regret it later on. Matumba Man channeling up the stun will be able to throw it out onto Sumail, actually. Gets a 3-man stun. Beautifully done by him. That's practically a miniature Ravage going out. The Acid Spray doing a lot of damage towards Fear, but now Arteezy thinking about closing the distance. Will not be able to do so just quite yet. Moon throwing out the Gush as well. They look to be forfeiting this lane of Raxes on the bot lane, but Matumba Man, he doesn't want to be taking it completely without a fight. He does end up getting jumped on by Fear. It's getting slowed up by the smoke screen. Matumba Man, Radiance was up and ready. He was able to get his farm back into the game, but now it's going to be all on Arteezy. Arteezy, who is silenced up right now, just for so long, it seems like Yawr with that level 3 silence was able to make sure that Arthur just wasn't able to do anything, completely ineffective, and the GG is called. Ladies and gentlemen, the side of Fear take the game off of an absolutely ridiculously good draft compared to the Radiant side. I mean, this Alchemist just being completely outlaned by Yawr tearing him apart. Yawr at multiple times, that was a great game. We saw quite a few people. We saw quite a few individual plays coming out as well from Yawr's side, and if anything, that was a prime example of why